And Rupert was talking about the Chinese stories, and I really wanted to start to be speaking about the Indian stories. And till then, all the list that we found was about a top 100 kind of exclusive club and all that stuff. I was in the FSA at the cafeteria. I was watching a debate of the House of Commons there, and the debate was about immigration, right? And of course, I had no problem. My visa is taken care of and stuff. But then I was thinking, you know, my existence in this country is going to be dependent by some 100-odd people sitting in that room, right? I would rather want to go back to my country where I'm a primary citizen. That was a point when I resigned. And wealth creators, now I'm being extremely careful here, right?
Hello and welcome to Business Today. If you're someone who's interested in tracking the richest in the country, you must have come across a report called the Hurun Rich List. Today in the show, I have the man who introduced the list in India, Anas Rahman Junaid. Welcome to the show, Junaid.
Thank you, Mukesh.
If you can tell us, how did you start the list? When did you begin it, and give a brief history of the whole thing?
I studied in Oxford, graduated in 2011. So I was working with the FSA, which is the RBI equivalent of the UK there. So there's a bit of a backstory wherein, so I always wanted to come back to India and do my own business. And I'm sort of the first entrepreneur from my family, but then there's nobody really to give me an advice on when to start or how to start and all that stuff. So because my dad is a doctor, so nobody was really there. So even when I had wanted to start small businesses, even before I went to Oxford, my family was not fully supportive of that. They always wanted to get me to get a job and all that stuff. So I was leading a comfortable life in the UK, no problem. I met the chairman of Hurun Report, Rupert Hoodsworth, who also happens to be from Oxford. He founded Hurun Report in 1999. And he started it off as a medium to start speaking about the Chinese entrepreneurship story, because China as an economy was just opening up at that point in time. And it was grown to become one of the most famous non-Chinese or British brands respected in China for the rich list and the valuation. So in 2011, I met him. Then I did the first global rich list for the Hurun Report. Just before I joined the FSA, I did a small internship with him, and that was a hugely successful project. And he asked me if I can, work with him. Then I told him, I don't want to work with you. If I have to do something now, I'm more than happy to invest and take a majority stake of the business and start something from, build it as my own business. If that is the case, I'm happy to take it forward. And that is the genesis of Hurun Report in India was. So he agreed to it, and it was working quite well, in the sense that we have offices in France, Sydney, all over. We have at least 19 offices. That's about 250 years back. India and China had the majority chunk of the world, the global GDP. India means the bigger India, right? So then after the colonization, looting, we're literally riches to rags story of the 200 years. And now China is now coming all the way on the top, right? And I really believe the next 10, 20 years is going to be for Indian and Chinese economies. And Rupert was talking about the Chinese stories, and I really wanted to start to be speaking about the Indian stories. And till then, all the list that we found was about a top 100 kind of exclusive club and all that stuff. But we wanted to bring it all the way down to 1,000, top 1,000 achievers kind of list. And that gives you a more perspective on the length and breadth of the Indian success stories through the eyes of the entrepreneurs. And that is the reason why I wanted to start the Indian edition. But when I decided to come to India, that was a funny story, which I haven't shared with anyone, but I'd like to share with you. So I was in the FSA at the cafeteria. I was watching a debate of the House of Commons there. And the debate was about immigration, right? And of course, I had no problem. My visa is taken care of and stuff. But then I was thinking, you know, my existence in this country is going to be dependent by some 100-odd people sitting in that room, right? I would rather want to go back to my country where I'm a primary citizen. That was a point when I resigned and, you know, decided to take Hurun back to there, more from an emotional, patriotic perspective. But then, yeah, so basically that. I thought the time was right for me to come back to India. Number two, I really thought Indian story is just exploding. And that is also very reflective in the rich list that we're doing. If you look at the global billionaires list, right? China is number one country creating most number of billionaires, followed by the US. And number three is India, right? And that is despite the fact that our unicorns have not even gone into public market or gone into IPOs, right? We're still in the private mode. And there are about 36 of them as of now, right? And the number is only going to go up. The moment they start getting listed, you will see a lot of tech-driven wealth creation in India. At that point in time, you will definitely see India taking some huge leap towards.
I'd like to ask you something here. Look, I mean, success stories and all of that are fine. What we are seeing right now is that economy is not in the best shape. We are still in recession, largely in recession, even though we saw some positive growth in this quarter. How, in your research, what have you found to explain that the companies are making solid profit, why, even though the country is going through a slowdown?
I think it's a great question. See, from the rich list category of the bunch of people, of course, they get impacted by the overall slowdown to an extent and so on. But what I've seen is these are possibly one of the best business decision makers in the country. That is why they possibly in the top wealth creators. And when I'm talking about wealth creators, now I'm being extremely careful here, right? We are looking at our wealth calculation is mainly based on the valuation of their respective businesses, right? So they're creating super valuable businesses in the country. So they seem to have figured out a way to really look at the crisis, manage it, and so on. But just yesterday, we launched a real estate rich list. And there was a chart in the real estate rich list, which basically had a list of top 9 listed companies that featured in the list, right? And we did, and in the chart, we tried to, we looked at their share price from the lockdown to now, right? So out of the 9 companies, 6 of them, in fact, has beaten. So they've all had a drop during the lockdown, but they've all beaten the share price and, you know, is performing better than what the price was the lockdown. The rest 3 of them was at 85 to 90% compared to the lockdown price. And so what I really think is this rich list is possibly an indicative of how these set of companies are doing, how super wealth creators are performing. But if you ask me, of course, the overall performance of the economy does have an impact on the evaluation of the business and so on.
I wanted to understand that you come up with pretty specific figures for the wealthiest, right? What their net worth is. So how do you go about in calculating this? Is this something, I'm pretty sure it's not something that the wealthy tell you. So what do you look at in your wealth measurement?
We do not take valuations from the people in the list. And unfortunately enough, I don't think none of the entrepreneurs, in my experience so far, has come back and told me that, you know, I want to be valued as this much. Can you put a value there? Nobody does that. So that's a great thing after having worked for the last 8 to 9 years. But we do gather numbers in terms of profitabilities, revenues, other assets and everything from the entrepreneurs. We at least request them, and some of them give the numbers and, you know, and share and so on. So most of the valuation is based on the annual reports and the revenue and the profitability. We apply at least 4 to 5 different valuation methodologies, and depending on the industry and the margin of the business, we give weightage to a certain multiple. For example, if somebody has got a very high margin business, very high margin business, and we possibly give some weightage to the PE multiple, and we reduce the corporate debts from there, whatever is mentioned in the balance sheet. It's an elaborative process that we do across the year, looking at about 5,000 companies. So just to give you a perspective, the day when the list is launched, we start the research for the next year. So we track around 5,000 to 6,000 companies every year. From there, we reach a cutoff, and then we try to verify the data. We ask for comments from the entrepreneurs. Whoever responds, if the response is valid, we try to incorporate them. And that's how it gets completed.
Yeah, Anas, about which sectors do you think are the most likely to lead in wealth creation in the next couple of years?
Yeah, so far India, if you look at the trend, right, it's been pharma and software and services, which includes all these tech companies, have been the IT services companies have been leading the wealth creation in the Hurun Rich List. So I really think the next real sector is going to be from this category or the new breed of entrepreneurs called the unicorns, right? I mean, that they are really going to create a lot of wealth creators in India. That is one thing that you would say, and that's happened in China also, right? It's been traditionally initiated as manufacturing, infra, and so on. But if you look at the last 5-6 years, it's been predominantly tech-driven companies that have been creating most number of wealth creators. So that is going to happen in India as well, considering the demographic advantage and so on. I think another sector that I foresee is also real estate, because just to give you some kind of number, an indication, right? Number of billionaires from the real estate sectors in India is about 8, right? China, it's 146. That's about almost 15 times more than India. And US, it's 29. And US 29 is despite the population of US being 1/4 of that of India and China, right? And India has to hit a GDP of 5 or 6 trillion US, whatever the target that the government has, there has to be more and more real estate billion-dollar enterprises from the country. So I think that is one sector that could possibly do a lot of wealth creation.
What makes you feel that the real estate sector is going to make a comeback? I think they've been going through really difficult times over the past few years.
Absolutely. Absolutely. See, multiple aspect to it, right? So I give you the macro trends, which is basically comparing the contribution of GDP and so on. Purely from empirical, numerical standpoint, right? If you look at I think real estate contributes about 13% to the Chinese GDP, which is about 13 trillion. Right. And for the US, it again contributes around 15%. And India, as of now, it's about 10%. Now, if you do a simple extrapolation and math without even getting into the ground reality, if India has to hit 5 trillion, if 10% of that is going to be contributed by the real estate sector, and as per a report by FICCI, if I'm not wrong, they predict about 13%. Of the Indian GDP would be contributed by the real estate sector. If that is going to happen, the amount of value creation that will happen in the sector is going to be extremely high, and there has to be a lot more billion-dollar enterprise from the real estate sector. So I'm just connecting all these numbers that is there in the various reports and predicting that. And it has to happen, I think.
Also about unicorns and startups, what kind of trend are you seeing there? Which are the categories where... which category startups are most likely to outperform in the years ahead?
I think one of the the traction that we see from an Indian. So I was listening to the Y Combinator pitch yesterday. I was invited as a Y Combinator investor, and one of the trends that I clearly see in terms of startups coming from India are the startups that are made in India, the built in India, but shipped for the US market. Typically, the SaaS. Kind of companies, right? That is gaining a lot of traction amongst the investors. But the only flip side to that is that the company could have been incorporated in India, but for them to get customers or new investors, they have to be flipped back to the US. So that is a bit of a problem, but that is definitely a sector that is gaining a lot of traction in terms of the companies that got selected in YC as well. The number two is, EdTech is definitely blowing up. It's going crazy. It's a function of digitization and, possibly even due to COVID and people working from home and so on. But then EdTech is definitely another area that's going on. And you wouldn't believe these, but the government hasn't regularized the crypto exchanges. But then India has some amazing crypto exchanges, which is doing some 15,000 crore transaction per month, right? So I would really love to see how.
Are you invested? Are you invested in cryptocurrencies?
No, not yet. I don't know if I'm allowed to say if I'm.
Are you worried about a possible ban?
Yeah, they're all worried. In fact, all these. So I spoke to about 7 crypto exchange founders over the last couple of weeks, and all of them are worried about the ban. They're doing amazingly well. I never knew India had such amazing crypto-based startups and founders in India. They're doing really big volume transactions as well. And one of them is, in fact, almost inching towards a valuation of $1 billion. That could be the first crypto. Indian crypto exchange with a valuation of almost $1 billion. So,
could you name the exchange?
I can tell that to you privately.
That's all right.
Yeah, but I'll definitely tell you which one it is. But then, they're doing extremely well. So I think I really think Indian companies built in India ship for the US. That's a great opportunity. Then EdTech is doing quite well. Then the crypto is basically based on whatever conversation I've been having so far.
Somewhere in the report I read that there'll come a time when the number of I think we added what 50 new billionaires in 2021. So
2020, last year, this year's list. That's
so
right.
If I'm not wrong, I think the report goes on to say that India will at some point create more billionaires than US. So how do you see that happening, and what are the reasons for it?
It's again compounding effect, right? You grow 1% every day, then the product that comes out of it is going to be monstrous. So I'll give you draw some parallels here, right? When we started the Hurun Global Rich List in 2012, right? US had more billionaires than China, at least by the US had about 500, China had about 300 to 400 and so on. But fast forward 8 years, China has got 1,100 billionaires and US has got 670 billionaires, US billionaires, right? And India is currently, when we started off the Global Rich List, India had about, 40 billionaires or something, right? For 30 or 40 billionaires. And now we have about 180 US dollar billionaires. And all that growth has happened over the last 5-6 years. And next, if we grow at this pace, and considering the demographic advantage that India as a market has, right? It's a no-brainer that India will have more wealth creators in terms of US dollar billionaires, over the next few years. It's just a matter of these unicorns and all getting listed. But again, I also want to qualify there, right? We also have a property called the Hurun Global 500, but it's basically the list of most valuable private companies in the world, 500 companies in the world. Again, if you look at, do a comparison, most of the big value companies, right, are led by countries other than India and China. Right, India possibly has around 5 entrants in the list. Reliance is there, TCS is there, 3-4 of them. But rest of them are mostly led by the US based companies and the European. And even China has about only 25-30 companies in the list. Right, so that again shows the life cycle of value creation. So we are creating value. We are creating $1 billion enterprises. Okay, that being a benchmark, if I can put it as a benchmark. But to reach the size, the sheer size of the US and some of these European companies, that might take a little more time because they've become more global. They've got offices all around the world. You take Amazon, they've got a big office in India as well. So the size is much, much heavier. But if you quantify based on $1 billion companies or billionaires, definitely we have a good chance in terms of beating US in the next 5-6 years, I guess.